Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Origin Exposed by Jen Crane, narrated by Dara Rosenberg. Chapter 1. I sat wrapped in Rowan Gresham's strong arms, thankful for my life and his. Gresham's warm skin was a welcome contrast to my own, and I pressed my cheek to his chest, absently nuzzling his wide shoulder. I was chilled to the bone. I made an effort to relax, to relish the comfort and security I felt from being so close to him. But my legs had begun to tremble. With every tremor, the physical manifestation of my shock grew stronger, until it intensified to a full-blown shake. I snapped my knees together and wrapped my arms around them. If they insisted on vibrating, I would constrict them into serenity. My plan didn't work. I was a ragged mess from the aftermath of the fight with Brandu, and bewildered to learn not only did I have living relatives, but I was descended of dragons who were feared, hated. And my father, about whom I'd sought information my entire life, was a magical breed I'd never heard of, an Omni. It was urgent that I learn more about him, as well as the dragons. It just so happened I had a captive audience of three such dragons. But as I scoured the mountainous crater in which they'd been imprisoned for centuries, I found no one. My stomach seized at the realization Gresham and I were the only two left on the rocky battlefield. The Dracontos dragons had traced away as we celebrated our victory over the powerful sorcerer Brandu. Gresham?
Hmm?
He'd recovered quickly and was absently nuzzling my neck. His breath was hot on my collarbone, and his hand crept dangerously close to my naked ass. Gresham, I said. The dragons are gone. His dark head snapped up, amber eyes wild as they bounced around the crater. He jerked his hand from me in confused horror, like I'd put it there.
Damn it, Gresham growled and stood to his full height. Damn it!
His curse reverberated through the cratered mountain's interior, echoing his frustration. His hands formed tight fists at his sides.
I can't believe I let them get away, he said, and began to pace.
His every move was rigid with anger.
He'll have my job for this. My job. Hell, he spat. He'll have my head. And rightly so. I had four of Thayer's prime enemies in one place and let them escape. Right under my damn nose.
Well, that's not really fair, Gresham, I said. You were knocked unconscious. Brandu nearly killed us both. He may have gotten away, but just barely. And he must be badly injured if the dragons were able to trace away and escape him.
He'll heal. They'll heal, he said, kicking a pile of rocks that sent stone and dust flying in a wide arc. I had them all here and could do nothing. I couldn't use my magic, couldn't trace. It was stupid to come here alone with you. I underestimated him and inflated my own ability. Damn it!
He stopped pacing and looked me up and down, a scowl replacing his handsome features. A snarl gathered his lips into a bitter pinch.
I continue to make poor decisions where you're concerned, behaving like a teenaged boy trying to impress a girl.
On some level, I preened with pleasure to hear the enigmatic man admit he lost his senses around me, that he wanted to impress me. I'd longed to wow him since the moment I first saw him. But I was also wary of the admission. Rowan Gresham was sharp, and not just intellectually. I feared if he suspected his feelings for me compromised him, he'd have no reservations about cutting me off. Gresham continued to curse himself, stomping aimlessly within the crater and mumbling as he stabbed his hands through the air at the sides of his head. I tried to deflect some of his stress by pointing out the things we had accomplished. We may not have captured Brandu, I said, but we learned a lot that could help the authorities. Not only is he still very much alive, but his interest in ruling
or destroy in there still exists. Gresham's eyes compressed to a tight squint.
You're saying that like it's a good thing.
No, I mean, we learned about a sick dragon breeding plan. We stopped it. And because we injured him so badly, his remaining dragons were able to escape. He has nothing now.
Oh, Brandy will always find a way. Dragons or no, he'll never stop.
Gresham stopped his pacing to face me.
I know you're trying to find the positive in the situation, Stella. But let me tell you how the leader of Thayer, the people of Thayer, will see it. I was the first one to see Brandu in centuries. I stood within feet of him, fought him. Not only did I not capture him, but a little girl fought him for me. I allowed him to escape, and I failed to discover where he's been hiding all these years.
I think you're taking this far too personally, I said, but he ignored me. His rant amped even louder, his voice booming throughout the cavernous space.
I discovered that three of the dragons responsible for the Steward massacre, until now thought eradicated, are alive. I didn't capture them. No, I allowed them to escape, too, and have no idea where to begin looking for them.
Worse, the dragons know. I know they exist.
They'll assume we're coming for them and go into hiding. Or come for us first.
I crept toward him and reached to console him, but he jerked away before I could touch him. Why are you acting like it's your sole responsibility to save Thayer? I asked. I mean, sure. We're taught at Radix we're supposed to defend our home. But it wasn't your job alone, Gresham. You fought Brandu. You nearly had him. I injured him, and we cost him his most valuable weapons. Not a bad day.
Stella, Gresham said, his face crumbling into a tortured mask. It is my job. I've been protecting the people of Thayer since long before you were born.
But, I paused, trying to comprehend. What do you mean?
What are you saying?
Gresham slammed his eyelids shut. He clenched his teeth with such force, I saw the muscles working in his square jaw. Gresham? You said you did special projects. I knew you were being intentionally vague, but what? What are you saying? He let out a ragged breath and found my gaze. His eyes were pained, shamed.
There is much I couldn't tell you at first. I should have told you when you first found your wolf, but by then I felt such guilt, and I was shocked to find that I gave a damn, Stella. I didn't want to see the disappointment in your eyes. I knew you'd find out eventually. I'm surprised it took this long. It only did because you're an outsider and your friends are all primos. I thought for certain the Redfern girl would recognize me from my dealings with her father, or one of those boys you associate with would piece it all together.
Blood rushed to my face, my ears. I heard white noise, a faint but consistent background to our conversation.
What the hell are you talking about, Gresham?
My voice rose as I grabbed at his arm and pulled him around to face me.
Tell me what?
My face was fevered, and I felt the familiar sting of tears threatening to form.
Stella, he said reverently,
smoothing the auburn hair back from my face. He bent to run his dry lips across mine before he said,
My position is Director of Defense. It's my job to eradicate threats to Thayer.
A burst of air escaped my parted lips, and I lay a hand on my heart to make sure it stayed within my chest. I was so shocked I couldn't take a full breath and sucked short, inadequate gasps of air. My mind scattered in a dozen directions. I tried to recall what Gresham had said to me over the course of the weeks I'd known him. I tried to process what I knew of Thayer, of Radix, of alternate forms. Why would someone as important as the Director of Thayerian Defense pursue me? Why would he become my unofficial guardian, injecting himself in my life as a mentor, a friend, a lover? What could he possibly have to gain from his association with someone like me who wasn't of this world, who didn't even know who she was? The answer hit me like a kick to the chest. I stood heaving, trying to gain control of myself, trying not to completely fall apart. My heart physically hurt at the betrayal, and the tears that had been taunting me finally spilled over and fell hotly onto my cheeks. I bent over and held my middle, a nauseated mass. Gresham was calling my name, but it seemed so far away. Stella? Stella, no, no, it's not like that. He spoke almost frantically and rushed to my side. I jerked from him, but was so off balance, I had to extend my hand for support. My knees were weak, and there was nothing on which to anchor, so I listed clumsily sideways before catching myself. I closed my eyes and took several slow breaths before attempting to speak again. Nothing came. I cleared my throat, attempted to clear my mind, and aimed for composure. But all I really wanted to do was crumble into a heap in the dirt. I cursed myself for my naivety, my inexperience, my ignorance. I felt stupid and small. After a lengthy interlude of self-pity, my mind kicked into gear, and in a moment of clarity, or self-preserving procrastination, it struck me that Rowan Gresham never talked about himself. He certainly never offered details. If he was in a mood to share, it would be smarter to save my grief for later, to put my own feelings on hold and hear what he had to say. And so, despite the fact that my heart felt like artisan glass that had splintered with 1,000 hairline fractures, I took advantage of the situation. If he was willing to talk, I would listen and endure the pain of his words. I steeled myself for the worst. "It's not like what, Gresham?" I asked. "That you weren't watching me from the very beginning? That you weren't monitoring my every development?" His chiseled cheeks filled with air before he blew it out and closed his eyes. It was obvious he'd rather skip this part. "In the beginning, sure," he admitted. "But it was my job to learn more about you. It was my duty to my people. Your people," I interrupted. "Your people? Thayer's my home now, too, you know. Are you telling me you found me, brought me here, helped me with school, with my metamorphosis, all to spy on me?" His brow furrowed in frustration. "Well, when you put it like that, it sounds worse than it was, Stella." "Put it like that?" My voice was loud, hard, angry. I had left feeling injured in the dust and was fast approaching enraged. "How else can I put it? It's pretty damn straightforward. And what about the rest? We very nearly slept together. You took advantage of me, knowing the whole time you were using me. You're an asshole." "Took advantage of you," Gresham scoffed. "You made the first move that night in your room. Do you know the restraint it took to allow you to straddle me for hours and not take you then and there? You'd mounted me already. We were halfway there. I knew you were attractive to me. You'd wanted me for weeks." "Oh, you couldn't possibly," I sputtered. Gresham was always so bold when he talked about sex. He had used that bravado to intimidate me, to infuriate me, to seduce me. I wasn't sure what his intention was at that moment, but I felt all three. "I sure as hell could know," he said with a smirk, "and did. Yet I made no move. But you woke and rubbed me like a wanton cat. You kissed me like you'd die if you didn't have me, and rode me through our clothes until I thought I'd die. Thank God we were interrupted." Gresham was delusional if he thought he was blameless. I recalled the thoroughness, the possessiveness with which he kissed me in my room. "What about after the attack on Caraway Manor?" I said. "You certainly took charge then." "After you handed it to me steaming on a platter. The entire room was filled with your desire. No man could walk away from that, Stella. And yet I did, if you'll recall." I recalled all right. Fragments of Gresham's thoughts had run through my mind the last time we'd been intimate. Wrong. Stop. Truth. Soon after, he pulled away from me and left with a hoarse, "I'm sorry." We hadn't talked about it since. He shook his head. "I haven't taken advantage of you, and you know it." "What we did physically isn't the point, Gresham. I'm not saying you robbed some virgin of her propriety. I know who and what I want. I'm a big girl with a big girl appetite. I did want you. Hell, I still do, and don't think I don't know how screwed up that is." "Then what is the point? Get to it so we can go home and get to what we both want." I laughed, but it held no humor. "That is so not going to happen, because the point is, you got close to me, befriended me, seduced me. You encouraged me to trust you, to depend on you, and somewhere along the line, I started to have feelings for you. And you let me, knowing all the while I had no idea you'd pursued me just to keep an eye on me." I closed my eyes and let out a tired breath. I felt just like the desolate terrain on which I stood. I was the world's biggest fool. And in my insecure imaginings, I thought Gresham looked at me every day and saw me as the fool I was for not catching on to his skeevy manipulations. "I didn't pursue you to seduce you, Stella," Gresham said, and grasped my chin so that I was forced to look at him. "That was never my plan. Hell, I considered you a child. I had Livia. My intentions were to bring you to Thayer and to monitor your form." "What if I'd turned into a dragon first, Gresham? What would you have done then?" That's the question I asked, but my knee-jerk jealousy to the mention of Livia was what most occupied my mind. Did he miss her? Was he regretful? Did he consider me immature and inexperienced in comparison?
"If your form had been a dragon, then I would have interceded."
My heart stuttered to a stop at his business-like tone. "What does that mean, interceded?"
"Thayerian sentiment has been strongly anti-dragon since the Stuart massacre," he said. "You know that. If a new dragon had emerged, an outsider especially, you'd have been assumed savage and condemned before you knew what hit you. The entire situation had the potential for catastrophe. Not just for Thayer, but for you too."
You still didn't answer my question. What could you have done if I was a dragon like my mother?
"I don't know," he said tersely. "But it was important to learn who you were, where your loyalties lie, what your vulnerabilities were."
"Didn't you have some underling that could have done that? Some special agent? If you're so important, couldn't you have sent someone else to spy on me? Surely there are other guys who are more my type, if seduction was your goal." I was hurting. I wanted Gresham to hurt too. I'd been humiliated, reduced to a mark to be targeted. I thought Gresham was interested in me, that I'd grown on him during the time we spent together, like he'd grown on me. He shook his head, ignoring my jab.
"The fewer people who knew about you, the better. Livia's premonitions may have alerted me to your existence, but even she didn't piece together you might have been a dragon. I handled you myself to keep those invested to a minimum."
Handled? Ouch. I fought back more tears. I had to remain focused on my endeavor to find more information while Gresham was offering it. "So, the people who knew about me are limited to the two of us, the Dracontos dragons, and Brandu?"
And Aemon, Gresham said. He knows.
Aemon? Professor Locklane? Why does he know?
Well, I had to give him a damn good reason to come with me to your world to get you, for one thing. He's also a trusted friend and an expert on dragon lore.
I scowled at Gresham.
Weren't you afraid he'd pronounce me a primordial savage, too? I wasn't, no. Aemon's as level-headed as they come, and trustworthy.
So, am I still in danger?
Does the fact that I'm half Dracontos mean I'm still heir to enemy status? Or does my father's omni-heritage negate that?
I didn't know what to think about myself.
Maybe Gresham could give me some clue, some direction. You know I don't see you as an enemy. Don't be ridiculous. As for you being in danger, that remains to be seen.
His shoulder slumped so low on a tired breath, I thought they might touch the rocky ground.
It's complicated. For now, let's leave this pit while we still can. We'll visit Aemon once we've recovered from the shock of the day. You can get to know him. We'll discuss how to proceed, form a plan.
I considered my options.
Yes, I wanted to get away from Rowan Gresham as quickly as possible. But where would I go? Back to my room at Saber Hall? I couldn't tell Timbra. I couldn't tell anyone about my dragon, about all I'd learned. Not yet. With Mom gone, the only people I had left were Gresham and my friends from Radix. My old college roommate Lizzie and the rest of the people back home had no clue about this world. The only ones who knew about my dragon form were people I couldn't trust. That scared the hell out of me. Besides being alone, I was in danger, and I wasn't even sure from whom. The tremors that had died down resurfaced with fury. The trembling wasn't limited to my legs this time, but surged through my body up to my teeth. I snapped my chattering jaws shut, but that only sent the movement through my neck, and my head bobbed like a cork at sea.
What's wrong?
Gresham searched my face for some indication of the source of my trauma.
What are you thinking?
My silence had said so much. I didn't cry again, but I wanted to. I stood hunched over in distress, my hand cupping my brow as I tried to squeeze a plan for what to do next from my brain. I had always thought I wasn't the type to fold under pressure, that I'd never be pitiful or whine about the unfairness of my circumstances, but damn it, I'd had a real hard day. I'd had infamous but unknown relatives appear from nowhere only to betray me. Gresham had almost been killed. Hell, I had almost been killed. I tore an evil sorcerer's throat out by my teeth. The first time I'd ever tried to kill anyone, to my recollection. And the man I'd fought to save, the one I'd come to trust and depend on, admitted he befriended me to spy on me. I very seriously considered curling my weary body into a tight ball and shutting out the world. I couldn't handle this. I wasn't equipped. I can't trust you, I said, as my voice cracked with emotion. I can't talk to anyone about what's going on. I don't have a soul to trust, to confide in. I don't know what to do. My wobbly knees finally gave way, and I crumbled to the rock and dust.
That's just not true, me Sinemum, Gresham said, and joined me on the ground. I asked to be in your life, and I meant it. I know what this looks like. I know you doubt my sincerity and feelings for you after what I've done. But you have to believe I was shocked to find you, to find us, when my intention was only ever to observe you. I sniffled, wiped my nose. How can you expect me to believe that when you've admitted you deceived me from the start? I was so tired. So tired. I don't know, he said, and heaved his shoulders.
If we have to start over, if I must work to regain your trust day by day, then it's what I'll do. One advantage to being so long-lived is developing patience enough to eventually acquire what's most valuable to you. I had no response to that. We sat facing each other in silence on the dusty ground, both of us at a loss for answers, for direction. Gresham, I finally said.
Yes.
What does me cinnamon mean?
Hmm? He hummed and ran his thumb across my knuckles.
Me cinnamon. You said that when you argued I could trust you.
Oh, my fair bride. Me sweet cinnamon. It's from the Canterbury Tales. It reminds me of you, your cinnamon hair.
Oh, I said. Real clever response, I know, after a man complimented me with Chaucer.
I don't know about you, Gresham said and squeezed my hand. But I'd like to find some pants.
I jerked at the sudden awareness. We were having the conversation sans clothes. I hadn't noticed. I was finally becoming accustomed to the forced nudity that came with having more than one physical form. After the initial embarrassment, I smiled. Hey, you have to celebrate the little victories in the face of such massive failures. Chapter 2. Gresham and I traced together to my room at Sabre Hall. Our nudity made the fragile situation that much more awkward. My subconscious brain chose to ignore my particular reality and instead rehashed all I had learned over the course of the day. I'd gained a mountain of knowledge about myself, Gresham, the dragons, Brandu, and of course about my mother and father. Once I began thinking about my situation, I couldn't stop. I was overwhelmed with information, not to mention emotion. I didn't know what to do next, or how to feel about Gresham, about any of it, really. What I needed was time to decompress, time to sort everything out, put the different bits of information into their correct mental boxes, and then open them one by one. I could leisurely consider the contents and make a plan. But there was no way I could do that. It was too much. I wasn't equipped to handle such pressure. It was all too serious and too depressing and too hard and too damn scary. A month earlier, I'd been a 22-year-old college kid with, okay, no real plans for the future, but also no pressure, no serious concerns. I drank too much and danced a lot. I got my nails done while taking Cosmo quizzes. The biggest challenge I faced was deciding between groceries or a new handbag. I may not have been fulfilled or challenged, but by God, I was stress-free. I miss those days. I wanted one of them. I was desperate to be rid of the constant, smothering pressure to study more, learn more, be better. I was sick of regretting the depraved history of my family and tired of worrying about my own potential for depravity. Ugh, to feel good for a change. I was lonely, still in mourning about my mother, and I wanted to forget for just a little while. Gresham, I whimpered. He whipped his head up at my tone, sending black hair in disheveled swaths across his forehead. The way I called his name was an entreaty, an appeal. His wide chest expanded and released on a ragged breath.
I want you, you know this, he said, but I'll not be accused of taking advantage of you again.
I closed the distance between us and stood just outside of touching, the front of my body so close to his that the heat of him left my back jealous and bereft. I know what you've done, Gresham. I held his gaze, forcing him to understand the depth of conviction behind my words. I know who you are, and right now I don't care. I want this. My voice cracked as I said. I need this. Gresham lowered his face with excruciatingly slow deliberation, his gaze never leaving my own, even as his lips brushed mine once, twice, back again. When he was satisfied he'd given me every opportunity to change my mind, he took them so softly, so sensually, that my addled brain short-circuited. I stood motionless, relishing the pleasure of his breath across my skin, the trace of his fingers along my collarbone, the brush of his thumb over my breast. He lifted my hair and bent to kiss my neck. I arched my spine in response and felt his smile of approval on my skin. Our kisses grew more frenzied, rougher, but no less sensual as I moved back and forth against him. My breaths left my body in pants. He pulled his mouth from mine and sought the approval in my gaze before ducking again. God, he was so talented. I was so needy, so very turned on.
I want you now, Stella.
Rowan Gresham brooked no argument. A whispered, yes, was all I could manage. He backed me up to the bed, kneed in my body and sucking lazily on my lower lip before he released it. His eyes were alight with wicked intentions, and I knew with sudden clarity that I was way out of my depth with him. I dove in anyway. I lay back as he stalked over me. That divine scent of earth and spice and man enveloped my senses, and I couldn't deny the ache within me any longer. Upon catching pieces of his fragmented thoughts earlier, a suspicion started to form. I wondered if we could communicate wordlessly. I need you, Gresham. I didn't have to say it aloud. He'd heard me all right. His eyes widened, and he bit down on his bottom lip, a lazy smile playing at the edges of his mouth. Dear God, Stella, are you trying to make me lose my seed before we've even started? No one calls it seed anymore, Gresham. Rowan. When we're together, I want you to call me Rowan. I tried the name out, rolled it around in my brain, if not yet on my tongue. Rowan, I don't know, seems strange. I've always thought of you as Gresham. I do know that I am loving this telepathy.
Are you always this chatty in bed? He asked.
No, not typically. Guess you bring out the best in me.
Let's see what else I can bring you to.
He approached me with the confidence, the finesse of a Spanish bullfighter, and I sucked in a hesitant breath.
Don't worry, I'll go slowly at first.
He pushed a mass of red hair away from my forehead. I nodded, putting on a front more confident than I felt. It's all right, I said with a wicked grin. You made sure I was good and ready. He smiled, chuckling so that his amber eyes crinkled at the corners. But his smile was soon lost to another look. This one was darker, possessive, intent. He found his way smoothly. I didn't want to chat anymore. I became lost. Lost to the exquisite force of his big body, to the feel of his powerful arms surrounding my head, and of his hands in my hair, on my face, on my lips. He murmured lover's words next to my ear.
So good, Stella. I never thought we could be like this. You're exquisite.
You always this chatty in bed, Gresham. He grinned, gazing down at me as lust battled with amusement.
Rowan, he said. I told you to call me Rowan.
Ultimately, lust won out. Slow and gentle was replaced by intentional, forceful, as he took my lips and swallowed my uninhibited cries of pleasure.
I can feel you pulsing around me, he told me.
I adored the feel of him inside me as I absorbed his unspoken words, welcoming this invasion into another of my private spaces. Afterward, Gresham slid beside me and pulled me tightly into him. I instinctively threw a leg over his middle and an arm around his chest. We lay there unspeaking, breathing hard and gathering our thoughts. Making love under the cover of darkness is one thing. Doing it wildly in broad daylight is quite another. There was no concealing darkness to hide anxious expressions.
No pretending to sleep to avoid immediate consequences. Lovers. We were officially lovers. I wondered if he would regret it. Again.
I dared to look up at him and found him staring at me. A smile I hadn't seen him make before slid across his face. So confident, so satisfied, so male. We didn't say anything. There was no need. We simply lay there, enjoying the moment and each other.
Chapter 3.
Wow. When I pursued you as a suite mate, I had no idea you'd be famous, Timber said with a straight face.
Oh, shut up.
Timber Redfern was not only my suite mate at Radix's Citadel for supernatural learning, she was a valued friend, my best friend. That she had adorable furry ears and knobby knees was of no consequence. We all have our little issues. Mine, of course, was that I didn't just turn furry. I also grew scales. Tough, armored scales of auburn and copper covered my body when in one of my newfound animal forms. In my other, I became a massive red wolf. I only knew one other person who had more than one physical form, and that was my lover, Rowan Gresham. Boyfriend wasn't a good descriptor. Gresham was decidedly not a boy. We had known each other long enough to be partners. Lover would have to do. Timbra's black eyes. Eyes were alight with mischief, her long lashes fanning across her cheeks with each blink.
I'm serious. Look around. Every person in this place either wants to be you or to sleep with you. And I'm definitely going to have to change panties when I get back to my room.
My burst of laughter was accompanied by an involuntary snort.
Never mind, not everyone. No way I'm screwing a snorter.
Timber Redfern was witty and hilarious, but very few people knew it. On the outside, she was stunning. Her willowy body looked great in anything she put on, and she walked with grace. Her presence was always known, and she didn't even try. But on the inside, she was quite shy and preferred blending in. The most striking thing about Timber, though, was her ears. The velvety pointed things protruded from the top of her dark honey hair and twitched whenever she was nervous or upset. Our grins were still pasted on our faces as we made our way to the back of Honor Roll Sushi Bar, where Boone, Ewan, Layla, and Mari were toasting tiny cups of sake. Timber was right. Gazes darted and eyes widened as I passed, and my keen hearing picked up fragments of whispers.
That's her, and you think it's all true?
There were a few comments on my appearance that set my spine a little straighter. I'd give a canine for an ass like that, or that hair, that skin, so exotic. I caught the end of one scrawny whore and wheeled around, my gut clenching and temper flaring at the insult. Lavia. Dean Lavia Miles, head of Radix's Department of Craft and Ritual. Not my biggest fan. It had been Lavia, a talented clairvoyant, who'd alerted Gresham to my existence in the first place. Her visions of me in his bed had been the cause of much contention between the two of them. That Rowan Gresham's bed is exactly where I had ended up lent her psychic abilities real credit. Not that she lacked credibility. She was dean of one of Radix's most important departments, after all. A fact she'd made miserably clear to me at every opportunity. When I first met her, I thought Lavia Miles sophisticated and lovely. Now, heartache and bitterness pinched her features, and she looked thinner, older. I did feel some regret for the way things had ended between she and Gresham. On the night of their breakup, she found me in Gresham's home dressed in nothing but his white button-down shirt. The circumstances had been innocent enough, but Gresham let her believe we'd been intimate. I thought this a fairly callous move on his part, but Lavia Miles was nothing if not calloused already. She could handle it. In fact, it looked as if she was on a date.
with none other than the sandy-haired saber bar playboy and bartender Knox Mahone. Livia made a big show of rubbing her fingers playfully over his, and then focusing her undivided attention on his every brogue and burr. "Message received, Livia," I thought. "You've moved on. I'll be sure to tell Gresham. Like hell."
"Ah, here comes Dragon Lady now," quipped Boone as we neared the table. "Take my seat, ma'am, please."
"Oh, you guys are freaking hilarious, aren't you?" All of the attention, good-natured ribbon or not, made me uncomfortable. I didn't like having a spotlight shone on me. I much prefer to blend into the background, especially among these people whom I'd come to love and trust.
"I told her that everyone here wants to do her or be her," said Timbra. "She thinks I'm exaggerating."
"Enthusiastic mm-hmms, and I know that's right," erupted. But one face remained stony.
"Ewan." He turned his dark head from me and mumbled something, almost inaudibly. He'd been in such a bad mood lately.
"What's that?" I asked.
Ewan Bristol's shiny black curls fell in layers, almost to the top of his shoulders and back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.